Welcome, everyone. I'm Amanda Williams, and joining me today is Jim Zobel. Now, several weeks ago on another live stream and on the World War I history podcast, we discussed MacArthur and Marshall's relationship in World War I. They were certainly aware of each other during that conflict, but contrary to what some MacArthur biographers suggest, there were no seeds of antagonism that came between them during that war. And perhaps later memory twisted some events that had taken place in World War I, but no hard feelings at the time of that war. By World War II and the Korean War, both are still serving in positions of great importance, and their relationship is incredibly consequential and increasingly complicated. Flash forward, at the end of his life, MacArthur seems very convinced by that point that George Marshall had betrayed him. And so today we're going to talk about their World War II relationship, their relationship during the Korean War, and then kind of try to get at what happened between them to make MacArthur feel that way. So Jim, we're going to talk about World War II and Korea, but set the stage for us a bit. Both men are going to cross paths again during the interwar year period. Give us a brief rundown of their interwar year careers and how they intersect.
Yeah, not much though. You know, there's a few times when they cross paths during that interwar period. You know, as we've talked about before, when the war ends, Marshall is aide to Pershing, and he's going to be going with Pershing everywhere for like the next 5 years until about 1924. He'll meet all the royalty, he'll be in all the parades, he'll do all the you know, high level things that with Pershing, and really be his like right hand man. There's a couple other staff members of Queckmeyer and another guy that work with Pershing as well. Whereas MacArthur will go into occupation duty. He's very sick that whole time in Germany. And then when he comes home in April 1919, he's immediately tasked to run the U.S. Military Academy at West Point. And so Marshall will be reverted back to his pre-war rank, and MacArthur will be one of four that keeps their rank. So it's very much a launching post for MacArthur after the war to have this delegated to him by Chief of Staff Peyton March. So while Marshall is serving with Pershing in Europe, and then when Pershing comes back to be Chief of Staff of the U.S. Army, MacArthur will be there at West Point. Mm-hmm. The thing is that they'll have some interaction because for football, more than anything, when MacArthur wants to bring cadets to Army-Navy game or wants to bring them down to Washington, he works with the Chief of Staff and works with Marshall on some of these things. But that's really the only interaction they have there. The thing is, though, is that in Valentine's Day, February 1942 or 1922, MacArthur marries Louise Cromwell Brooks. And Louise Cromwell Brooks had been very much linked with Pershing's staff officer, this guy, Queckmeyer. And almost upon meeting MacArthur, she throws him over and immediately agrees to marry Douglas MacArthur. Now that, you know, it's rather, you know, a strange circumstance that happens. And Marshall will never say anything about it, but he knows Queckmeyer. He knows the whole situation, you know, and how bizarre this is. And then was Pershing really, you know, exiling them to the Philippines in 1922 as you know, a lot of people thought. And so Marshall has to know about this and you know, MacArthur kind of moving in on this other guy's girl, but never says anything about it, you know, at all. 24, Marshall will go to China. That's where his experience first is with China, you know, which become important later. He goes there and serves in Tianjin, and he's with the 15th Infantry over there. And he gets a taste of all the international intrigue that's going on, you know, because you've got the Soviets with Chiang early on, and then, you know, they'll finally dump all the Soviet advisors. He sees, you know, all these different international powers still working in China. And so it'll be a good education for him. MacArthur goes back to the Philippines for two more tours, 22 to 24, and then 28 to 30. and 27, you know, MacArthur will get divorced from Louise, and the same time Marshall's first wife dies, you know, so both these guys have these, you know, personal things that are going on as well. 30, MacArthur's chosen to be chief of staff, and Marshall has then been serving as, you know, after his wife dies, he has a fort down in Georgia who runs perfectly. He's an officer with the 8th Infantry. And then he takes over the infantry school at Fort Benning, which is critical for him because this is where he starts to notice all these officers, keep them in his little black book, all these people that he is going to call on in World War II to basically run the army that will win this. So both of them have very different careers going on at this time, but almost very similar because Marshall will follow MacArthur in that path of going on to chief of staff. Now, they point, a lot of authors point to this friction about MacArthur's posting Marshall to the Illinois National Guard in 1933. And what it was MacArthur wanted Marshall to be chief of infantry, which was a major general's position. And Marshall was a colonel at that time. Thing is people had to retire. They had to, you know, get out of the way for Marshall to be able to take this position. The Illinois post was very important because of it running Chicago, you know, which is such a big city. It's very political. It's very tumultuous. And MacArthur sees Marshall as the best put for this job before, you know, because he can't make him chief of infantry. And a lot of people say that MacArthur shuffled him off to a backwater, but Marshall pretty much excelled at the job, did a great job, didn't have any animosity towards MacArthur, you know, over this. And when MacArthur leaves chief of staff in 35, he puts Marshall on the brigadier general list. And even Pershing at that time was like, why are you overlooking Marshall? And MacArthur was like, I picked him as chief of infantry. You know, I couldn't make him that. But now I put him on the brigadier general's list. So I don't think he's looking askew at Marshall or anything like that. And MacArthur will set up the four army plan, which then becomes the basis for the army organization, which Marshall will then refine to go into World War II. So they've laid the groundwork for what will come after. When MacArthur goes off to the Philippines in 35, Marshall will go into war plans in the War Department and then be deputy chief of staff. And then 39, he's made the chief of staff. And MacArthur is now retired from the military. But then during that interwar period, that's when that first correspondence really that we have that starts to get so voluminous starts between the two, because MacArthur is writing to the chief of staff asking for materials for the military defense project in the Philippines. And Marshall knows if things start hitting the fan, he's gonna recall MacArthur to the colors, you know, and that's all Marshall that does that. So they don't have a lot of interaction, but their careers are definitely intersecting and going along similar lines.
So when World War II begins, you've kind of already laid this out. Marshall is chief of staff. Right. MacArthur has been recalled and is serving in the Philippines. What are they doing? How are they going to spend the first months of the war?
Well, of course, Pearl is the shock that, you know, gets everybody. And for MacArthur, it's you've got your Air Force wiped out the first day. For Marshall, it's we've had our fleet destroyed at Pearl Harbor. We've lost all that bomber force I've built up in the Philippines. You know, it's a complete disaster. But Marshall's entire belief, a lot of like MacArthur, is you can't let him see you down. You gotta put on a brave face, and it doesn't faze Marshall that they've had this. He knows they've got to build it back up. So in those first few months, he's looking at the world. MacArthur is looking at the Philippines, because in a few weeks after, you know, the bombing, he's got the Japanese at his doorstep. Marshall, we know, is you know, doing a great deal to help MacArthur. He's working with MacArthur. But he's also working on a worldwide basis. You've got to build up an army because you don't have one. You have to build up airplane supply because you don't have any. You've got to build up all these munitions and weapons of war because you don't have any. You know, it was like MacArthur had said in 40, too little, too late. You know, it was just the way America was. It wasn't really Marshall's fault. It wasn't MacArthur's fault. They had come out of the Depression. They were, you know, bled dry. And all of a sudden here you've got a war on two fronts, and you've got to salvage all these allies who are at the brink. You know, Britain's been hammered by the Nazis. The Russians are now being hammered by the Nazis. And you've got China on the, you know, the brink with the Japanese full scale in there. And now you've got this new war for everybody. So it's a lot of stress for all of them. And MacArthur's looking at trying to stave off destruction in the Philippines, and Marshall's looking at staving off destruction around the world.
Mm-hmm. And I think, like we talked about last time, they're both going to be approaching it from their point of strength. MacArthur has that warrior mind. Marshall has that superb military mind. Yeah. And they're both seem to be in the proper position to kind of use that. Let's talk about Bataan and Corregidor, 1942. Now, the Philippines is doomed. I think everyone in Washington probably knew that. I think MacArthur knew that too. So here's the problem. Marshall is sending him messages about help coming, right? But no help is coming. I mean, that's just not something the U.S. is capable of doing at that point in the war.
Right.
The U.S. wasn't ready for this war. The Philippines is then essentially considered a loss before it's even lost.
Right.
MacArthur sees these communiques coming through from Washington from Marshall, and he repeats a lot of this to the men under his command, giving them hope, rallying them to a doomed cause. Now, obviously, that's a, you know, you can't tell all the people in your command, you know, we're in trouble, we're doomed. That's not going to be helpful. But do you think that these communiques from Marshall are the start of MacArthur starting to really distrust him or resent him in some way? What do you think?
Well, when the war starts, yeah, you've got messages up until about January 4th saying, we're going to supply you, you know, we're going to work to get you. We've got planes and ships coming. The Pensacola convoy was headed that way, but, you know, got rerouted to Australia, and all those planes go down to Java where they get lost. But they're also saying, you know, we're going to, you know, our sea power isn't capable of doing this, but we're going to gain air control over the Malay barrier. We're going to, you know, control the air over Mindanao. And, you know, those are coming as late as January 4th. And it's not till February 8th that they really tell MacArthur nothing's coming. We've got, you know, all these commitments worldwide. The Navy can't do it. And that's, you know, when they finally break down and tell him. Now, the thing is like you said, MacArthur on the 15th of January, he issues that statement to the troops. Help is on the way. Thousands of ships and planes, men, material on it. I can't tell you when it's going to get here, but it's coming. And the thing is that is everything that is in those messages that the War Department is telling MacArthur. And he signs his name to it. You know, he could have signed, you know, or said, this is what I'm being told by the War Department. This is what I'm being told by the president. This is what I'm being told by the chief of staff. But he doesn't. He signs his name to it. And the thing is does he believe that? Does he believe that men and material are coming? John Buckley, who's the PT boat commander that takes MacArthur out of the Philippines, he says he doesn't believe that MacArthur, you know, believed that. He believed that he thought it was doomed, you know, once the air power was gone. And then once the Japanese have landed and they immediately get the reversal that goes back into Bataan Corregidor. And so that's the crux of the situation is MacArthur gilding them, you know, to fight on. A lot of those people back in the War Department, you know, all their prediction had come true because they said there was no way you're going to hold the Philippines, you know, and MacArthur was like, well, this is my job. I've got to get ready and do this, but it was too little, too late. And then all the problems with the Air Force, which we've discussed before, just kind of seals that fate. But does it make MacArthur resent Marshall. I don't know about that. You know, Marshall and Eisenhower, you know, Eisenhower says he thinks MacArthur should just be left there and, you know, suffer right. the fate of the command. Whereas Marshall is more like, no, we've got to do everything we can to help him. It'll be Marshall that gets him out of there come March, you know, that convinces the president they have to get him out of there. I mean, they'll try these blockade runners, but they can't do it. You know, the blockade to the Philippines is a bit too much, you know, or at least they think it is. And so a lot of these, you know, they can't pay a captain enough to send, you know, a freighter up to the Philippines with food or anything like that. The only way they can get it in there is submarine. And so when February comes along and they finally tell him that things are, you know, we're not going to be able to do it, that's when Quezon makes the neutrality plea. That's when they get him out. And that's when they start thinking, you know, MacArthur's got to get out too. So, but does he hold animosity? I think MacArthur and a lot of the people that were under Marshall, they said that MacArthur, having been chief of staff, he has a lot of respect for that position. Now, he'll speak to his people.
Right.
You know, and there'll be a lot of talk going on in headquarters, but, you know, he doesn't really confront Marshall or the president, you know, vociferously, like, you led me on, you know, right. did this or to me or anything. I mean, he'll be enough to handle without all that. But yeah, I think MacArthur knows what the job is, and, you know, he's not going to disrespect him officially.
And given how capable he is of wielding the press, in you know, in terms of keeping his stories on the front page, I imagine if he really was upset with Marshall or the president about some of those messages, I'm sure that would have ended up in a newspaper somehow.
Even after
the war.
And MacArthur pushes the envelope always. You know, he even when they tell him there's no supplies, it's like, well, you got to get supplies. You know, this is the most important theater on the planet, you know. And that will irk them quite a bit. You know, Stimson will send Eddie Rickenbacker out there to tell MacArthur to shut up. You know, just you're causing way too many problems. We know what's going on, but just stop it already. You know, and so they know what's going on, and you know, Marshall will always have a way where he's irked by MacArthur, but it's, and MacArthur will always be like, This information has to be taken to the president right now. You know, he's got to understand what's going on. And Marshall, later on, when he reads a MacArthur message, he'll always be like, I wonder if I should take this to the president right now, you know, which is kind of a sarcastic thing. And people pick up on it, but it's a very sly, dry thing. Whereas in MacArthur's headquarters, you know, they'll be calling everybody Marshall's henchmen. So it's a different culture between the two.
I've always thought it was interesting. I've always thought it was interesting that Eisenhower's the one in Washington giving the advice that we should just leave MacArthur there. Right. You know, if he wants to die there with the defenders, you know, let him die there.
Yeah.
And then Marshall, with that superb military mind that we've talked about, he's the one that says, no, I think this guy might be valuable to us,
yeah.
you know, in the future. And so he's unwilling to kind of let this be an Alamo for MacArthur 100%.
I was reading in Forrest Pogue's biography of Marshall. He said that Marshall wanted a man like MacArthur in the Pacific because anybody else was going to be run over by the Navy. He's the one that's going to keep the Navy, you know, not straight, but it's always going to keep them on their toes, never let them have everything, you know, and that'll be the biggest problem in the Pacific, is that inter-service rivalry, you know, that goes on, and that'll irk Marshall quite a bit. But it's just interesting, I thought, that Pogue would say that,
mm-hmm.
you know, that he's there to keep them, you know, and that's the thing, you know, whereas the war plans division in Washington, they plan the war for Europe. You know, for MacArthur, he plans it.
Right.
He plans the Pacific, And so I think Marshall looks like it is almost a, you know, a break. You
know, right. Break. He can outsource that.
Yeah, he can. Yeah. He can do that part, and I'll leave him out there. I'll only go visit him once. You know, we'll never bring him here to Washington. And that's another thing that was so interesting, because, you know, MacArthur, Churchill, Roosevelt, they are master speakers. They've got a command of the English language like no one else does. They're all very emotional people. Does Marshall never want them to get in conference together? Because, you know, what would come out of that meeting of Churchill, MacArthur, and Roosevelt, you know, when they all get talking amongst each other? And so, we always talk about MacArthur never wanting to go to Washington, but maybe Marshall doesn't want him there for these meetings.
Now, that would be a fascinating, like, what if had the three of them gotten in a room together? I would have loved to be, they would have had to have one of those talking sticks to make sure everyone had time to say their piece. Right.
They had to put it on the clock when they start talking.
All right. Now, next question. So we've, I think, established that MacArthur can be a difficult man to manage. He's highly intelligent. He's a decorated war hero. He's very sensitive. He's also very savvy when it comes to public affairs. George Marshall has a difficult job on his hands, but he does try very earnestly, I think, to help MacArthur. I mean, not just, you know, in terms of Bataan Corregidor, but it does seem that he does outsource a lot of this running of the war in the Pacific to MacArthur, but he does try to help him. I mean, he does try to have his back, especially in terms of the inter-service rivalry, but all through the war. What is he doing in Washington to try to help MacArthur?
Well, I always say that I don't ever think that MacArthur realized that Marshall was the best friend he had in Washington, because Marshall does work to get him supplies early when nobody else wants to give MacArthur supplies, you know, even before the war. And then once it starts, you know, they build up their air power. I mean, they'll take it all back during Guadalcanal, you know, and the Papua phase, but he is always working with them. You know, a king is the most anti-MacArthur person is, and that's Ernest King, the chief of naval operations. Eisenhower said in his diary that the best thing that could happen for the war effort was for someone to assassinate Admiral King. But Marshall is the only one that can make King play nice, because King has utmost respect for Marshall, because he's calm, he's cool, always collected, you know, never gets emotional, always a matter of fact, you know, and always, you know, is a gentleman, but he's forceful as a gentleman, you know. And so that's the thing is, you know, and even Henry Stimson, the Secretary of War, will say, you know, this Navy thing that against MacArthur is just infantile. And Marshall will think the same thing. And so, yeah, he will support him. And when he does go out there in December of 43, he does, you know, level out with him what's going on, you know, how strategy might go, how he might not get back to the Philippines, you know, and he is straightforward with him pretty much the whole time. When it comes to the going back to the Philippines, Marshall will side with the Navy, but he has no qualms about telling MacArthur that. And then once it becomes realized that they don't have the forces to go to Formosa, Taiwan, then he fully backs MacArthur because he sees it from the rationale of the way the situation is. And so, yeah, he will back him, but he will also be the organizer. You know, I can't afford this right now because we got this going on in Europe. But he will always be the one that, you know, supports him in front of the Navy assault that goes pretty much the whole war, you know, throughout that time. So yeah, there's a lot of, you know, people will say that when they send MacArthur a message that they have to give it to Marshall first, just to make sure that it's okay. You know, Marshall would deny that later on, but you know, it kind of says the whole thing, you know, to about these two. And I think Marshall just knows how to make people do the best that they can do and you know, not get out of control, which will end when World War II ends with Douglas MacArthur.
So skipping forward, the war ends. MacArthur is tapped to lead the occupation of Japan. Is Marshall part of that decision? And what contact are they going to have during the occupation period?
Now, at the end of the war, MacArthur was getting to feel like, you know, again, like he knew more than most people, you know, especially when they start thinking about going into Kyushu and Japan, and he's difficult working with the Navy again. You know, the Marshal's like, can you go and meet with Nimitz and Guam? And MacArthur's, you know, I'm too busy. And so he's becoming kind of, you know, I'm the man of the Pacific. Marshall does back him as a Supreme Commander, Allied Powers. He puts him forward. You know, we have the stories where Leif Sverdrup, who's MacArthur's engineer, is with Truman the night he picks MacArthur, but a lot of the biographers say that Marshall was definitely behind MacArthur being picked as Supreme Commander, Allied Powers. They do have a lot of interaction. Marshall will end being Chief of Staff come November. He wanted to go home and be with his wife. You know, the pressure of the past 5 years had really been something else. But they do have a lot of contact during that, especially those first 2 weeks, like we talked in Japan, where MacArthur comes out and says, because he thinks that they're going to blame holding all these people in the army on him. He says, I only need 200,000 troops, not a million troops. Whereas for like a couple of years, Marshall had been working on this plan to keep all the troops, you know, in the field to be able to run all these commitments that they got around the world. And then MacArthur makes this statement and that blows up, you know, all this work that they had done. And Marshall doesn't like, you have to say, you know, what you're going to say to other people to me first. He says, hey, you know, man, can you let me know when you're going to say these kind of things? Mm-hmm. You know, because we've been working on this stuff for quite a while. And so it's that typical Marshall of, you know, not wanting to cause a fight, but, you know, being forceful enough to like, you know, what are you doing? And MacArthur came back and said, you know, I didn't mean to cause a ruckus, but he did. You know, we know that he did. Because he thought he was going to get blamed for this thing. And then November 45 comes along and Marshall is out as Chief of Staff. And we know that, you know, he gets picked to be Truman's rep in China to try and work out the China situation with the communists and the nationalists under Chiang. And he flies through Tokyo and he stays with MacArthur at the American embassy, but it doesn't seem like they talked about anything. And Marshall will write him back and just say, thanks to you and Jean for the hospitality. I appreciate it.
Hmm. He and MacArthur have, I think, very different ideas about America's interests in China at that time. So here you have MacArthur involved in the occupation, and then you have Marshall being sent there as the, you know, special representative of the United States over there. Can you lay out this period for us, and what is Marshall really doing? And although China isn't in MacArthur's portfolio, does Marshall's China mission increase MacArthur's sense that maybe they're not on, they don't think in the same way about China?
Well, not, it doesn't get vocalized till much later, you know, about anything about that. I mean, Marshall goes over there because they're worried about the Soviets have taken over Manchuria. And they're worried about them being there. They think that the only way they can keep the Soviets out of coming into China or, you know, helping the communists as much as they can is by uniting those two elements. And so when Marshall goes over there, the idea is to try to get Mao and Chiang to work together, to have a coalition type government. Of course, Marshall shows up and Wedemeyer, who's the, you know, the U.S. rep there, as well as John Lytton Stewart, they're like, there's no way you're going to get these people together. They are not interested in working together. And when Marshall gets there, he meets with Chiang, he'll meet with Zhou Enlai, he'll meet with Mao, and they'll all be, oh yeah, you know, we got to work together. But the Kuomintang, which is the, you know, the party under that Chiang is backed by, you know, you got these two brothers, Chen Fu and Chen Kuo, and they're totally against Marshall. They want to destroy the communists. They want to get into up north and have the Americans take them up there and resupply them and have them wipe out the communists. And so while Chiang is like saying, yes, we'll work and we'll have this ceasefire, they're both looking to enhance their position. And Marshall will travel all over China. He'll get these committee members working to try and get these things together. But it's not going to work. You know, both sides want control of China. And, you know, as much as they'll say, oh, yeah, we're working to this, and in the background, they're stabbing Marshall in the back. You know, the communists and the Kuomintang just want him out of there. Marshall will be telling Chiang the whole time, you've got to reform your government. You've got to reform the Kuomintang. You know, you've got to get the people on your side or none of this is going to work. And we're not going to give you supplies and materiel and everything, you know, until you get this thing together. And he'll say it forcefully and straight out to both Madam Chiang and Chiang. And Chiang will say, yes, I know. But you know, they see, oh, I've got this ability to squash the communists here first, you know, before we have any kind of come together. So when Marshall goes back to Washington in late 46, before he'll come back later, or early 46, come back later, it all falls apart. You know, there's no way this thing is going to work. And later on, Marshall will be saying, you know, Chiang ruined the chance. Even, you know, Wedemeyer, he'll want to give supplies and materials to Chiang, but he'll say right to him, you've got a disaster over here, you know, with the Kuomintang. Because, I mean, you get into 47 and 48 and any kind of dissension whatsoever, you know, Chiang's guys are executing him, you know, whereas the communists saw what was going on. Oh, we have to act like we're more for the people. You know, right. We can't be going around pushing people around, executing them. They see the writing. And that's where it kind of drifts off, you know, to more people saying, oh, well, maybe we'll go with these communists, you know. And you've got a lot of people in the State Department and Washington saying, oh, these are agrarian reformers, you know, whereas Marshall knows because he met Mao and Mao was ticked off about that. No, we're hardline Marxist, you know, Leninist communists.
Right.
And so it's a lot of friction about what to do. And then, you know, MacArthur, he never really says what he thinks. You know, he keeps his mouth kind of closed. He's got close connections with Chiang because he's got his advisor. He's close with Li Jensun, the VMI graduate who is one of Chiang's commanders there. You know, there's a lot of goofy things going on with those people as far as what's going on. When you get into this congressional discussion in 48 about do we supply Chiang, do we keep, you know, propping him up? Because, you know, they came to the realization that Chiang can't do this. The only way this is going to work is if we put $5 billion into China and we go in there and run the war. And they're not going to do that. And so they asked MacArthur to come back and testify to Congress. And he says, you know, I'm in Japan. I don't have, you know, enough to come back there and be able to talk about this. You know, Wedemeyer and other people will say MacArthur knows very well what's going on in all these other regions, you know, but he doesn't really vocalize it until after the firing. Those that tour around America, he'll say, you know, we gave up you know, China, we gave it to the communists, you know, and he'll like, you know, generalize it at that time. But even MacArthur, you know, because it kind of ties into Korea later on with the China thing. When MacArthur gives that speech in 50 about the Americans' littoral defense, you know, South Korea's kept out of it. You know, so, you know, how much is he really looking at it as you know, seriously at that time? We're not sure, you know, because it doesn't come out until like November of 50. Of exactly what MacArthur thinks the communist Chinese are doing.
Isn't it true, though, that pretty early on into the occupation, MacArthur is suggesting that the occupation's been successful? I mean, we're talking just a couple years into it. It's been successful. Yeah. And doesn't he want to go to China and help Chiang?
That's what Chiang wants. You know, Chiang wants him to come over there and be like a supreme commander. And we've got right. messages to that effect in about June of 1950.
But that's not MacArthur's idea.
Yeah, no, I don't okay. believe it is. You know, like I think MacArthur at that time when in 47, when he says the occupation is over, he's thinking about the 48 election.
Okay.
You know, and maybe coming back for that.
Okay.
But you know, even then MacArthur doesn't say exactly, you know, what he means by that. But I MacArthur is always kind of cards close to the chest until it kind of comes out to exactly what he you know thinks, and that doesn't come out till the middle of the war, you know, with Marshall, you know.
Right. Yeah. All right, let's talk Korean War. What are both men's roles at the start of that conflict in 1950?
Well, as we know, MacArthur is the Supreme Commander in Japan, and Truman picks him to be the UN commander when they get the UN involved. MacArthur holds off, you know, with that Pusan perimeter while he can put together that Incheon thing. And then finally, early September is when it comes off. And that's also, you know, that's also when Marshall comes back as Secretary of Defense. Lewis Johnson was a very vocal Democrat, thought he ran the whole government, and kind of exacerbated all the other Democrats in the cabinet. Everybody just thought he was a blusterer. And so when the war started, because the U.S. forces had been drawn down so much in the 1940s, Lewis Johnson kind of gets the blame for that. And the press goes and kind of just crucifies him. You know, it was everybody, but he was just somebody they wanted to get rid of. And that's when Marshall once again is turned to by Truman, you know, to do this. Marshall had been running the Red Cross during that 49-50 period. But then he's brought in right after the, you know, Incheon. And Marshall's got his people there. It's not much to have to switch because all his guys that he had picked during World War II are now in control. You've got Omar Bradley as head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. He was a big Marshall guy. J. Lawton Collins is the chief of staff of the infantry of the army. He's a big Marshall guy. You're going to put Eisenhower back over in Europe as hard of shape. He's a Marshall guy. And as well, MacArthur is dealing with a lot different than in World War II, where basically you had to take orders from just the JCS, whereas now he's responsible to Defense Department, the State Department, the UN, the President. And so when Marshall comes in as Secretary of Defense, that is right when MacArthur has succeeded at Incheon. The JCS has sent him the plan for going north. MacArthur's all for going north, and they're trying to figure out what to do. And here's the thing, Marshall sends him this message in late September saying, we want you to feel unhampered both strategically and tactically going into North Korea. Well, you know, that's a blank check, get out of jail free card to Douglas MacArthur. Who he's going to, which he's going to use over and over again. And here's the goofiest thing. You know, they knew they had all these problems, you know, with him in World War II. And even Eisenhower says that at the Defense Department right before he goes to Europe. You know, you got to keep an eye on him because he's going to push the envelope and ask for forgiveness later. And, okay, we're going to send you into North Korea. We're seriously worried about getting into a war with Communist China and the Soviet Union, but we're going to send you up there right by the border, and don't feel hampered strategically and tactically.
Yeah, you know, a problem.
So here we go. You know, they go up north. You know, the Mao immediately says, you come across that border, I'm going to make moves. Everybody discounts it. You know, MI6, G2, CIA, Defense Department, even MacArthur, even when the Panacker memos come out about Zhou Enlai telling them we're going to come across, they all discount it pretty much. And then they come in at the Chongcheon River, you know, in November of 1950. And that's when MacArthur shifts from everything's under control to we've got men and materiel pouring across a border. I got to bomb these bridges or my command faces destruction. And, you know, this is where the crux of it comes out, because Marshall sends him a message. Do you think that the Chinese are making these moves because the hydroelectric dams on the Yalu River, because we're threatening those? And MacArthur comes back with a history lesson about China. And kind of like Napoleon said, these guys ever get their act together and unify themselves, they're gonna go after the world. And that's what MacArthur thinks. You know, they are unified now. He said he had all these conversations for years with Manuel Quezon, because that was Manuel Quezon's biggest fear, was China uniting. They've taken over Tibet. They're moving into, you know, Indochina, getting in all in there. And then they come into Korea. And we know that Mao's whole reason was, you know, not so much that they thought they were coming into China, but I'm going to destroy the 1st Marine Division. I'm going to give them a bloody nose. I'm going to let them know who the major power in China is. I don't care if I lose a million people. And I think MacArthur had seen this. And that's what he lays out in that message to Marshall in November about these hydroelectric dams, that no, it's not the dams. This is the switch in China's outlook on the world. And this is something that's going to be 100 years into the future. And Marshall's response to it is, I don't think you understood my questions, you know, because I was asking about the dam. And, you know, Marshall didn't understand MacArthur's response. About what he thinks. And so when China comes in, you know, MacArthur's thinking, this is it, you know, this something's got to be done now. A lot of people say it's, you know, for revenge, for getting caught with his pants down, probably a lot to that. But we know where we are now, and we know what he said after the war. Now, it does come down to, you know, them wanting to get out of the war as soon as the Chinese come in seriously in December. J. Lawton Collins is like, we got to get out of there. Bradley's like, we got to get out of there, you know, even though they were the ones that went in there. And so now all the war aims change. You know, they're going from unite the country, hold free elections, to, you know, let's kill as many as we can to try and get them to the table. Even Under Secretary of Defense, Robert Lovett, he's like, we need to just let Korea go, even if that means the fall of Japan.
Wow.
Because our main concern is Europe. Everything is Europe.
Right.
And so that's what you're dealing with back in Washington. And MacArthur will say, no, we've got to fight this thing. You know, we need Chang's troops. I need to bomb these bases in Manchuria, conventionally blockade the coast. They're all like, no, we can't do that. The Allies aren't going to let us do that. You know, they wouldn't let us have hot pursuit of the Chinese and, you know, with Soviet pilots that were coming over the Yalu River, and they had their sanctuary. And MacArthur's mind is, you know, well, this is just murder. You've got these people up here just fighting for nothing, you know, in a dive for tie. And he'll be vocal about it. And Marshall writes out that message of, you know, you have to clear everything with us before you clear it, you know, before you say it to anybody else, the gag order, you know, which MacArthur will keep violating until March, when it comes down to the pitch to the Chinese commanders, and then the Joseph Martin letter. And then that comes down to, you know, Marshall being along with, you know, getting rid of them. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. According to a number of sources, Marshall is very instrumental in MacArthur's firing. It's not something he takes pleasure in. It's not something that he's orchestrating. But just by being in favor of it and giving that support to President Truman, he does play a very important role in it happening, doesn't he?
Yeah. I mean, after that Martin letter is read on the House floor April 5th, where he, you know, MacArthur is like, you've got to use the Chinese nationalists, and kind of gets into the policy discussion, you know, heavily. And that's when Truman knows he's got to get rid of him. And he'll bring in Marshall and Acheson and Alvin Barkley, the vice president, the next day. And Marshall will be like, you got to move cautiously on this. You know, we can't just, you know, destroy him out there. We've got to, you know, take this. Let's think about it. I think, you know, and pretty sure Truman had made up his mind already, but wanted to run it by this people. And Marshall wants to run it by J. Lawton Collins and Omer Bradley. You know, is this what we need to do? All of them come to the conclusion that MacArthur had challenged civilian rule over the military. And I think they all found it distasteful, but they all go for it. And they all approve this measure to relieve MacArthur of his commands. And so, whereas he, like you said, he doesn't orchestrate it, but you know, he's part of it. He's part of it. And I think that's, you know, after that, that's, you know, MacArthur will pretty much, even though he'll say officially he has no animosity to Marshall, we know from interviews of people that he knew at the time that he was very vocal about it, that Marshall didn't explain his views correctly, that he wasn't, you know, telling the president what he needed to hear. And that's the thing, MacArthur thinks he'll come back and be able to sway the people into really going full force in this war against the Chinese and the Koreans. You know, he doesn't realize Americans are done with war. You know, there's 6 years after World War II, they're still like, no.
Mm. Do the two men have any contact after the firing?
Well, when MacArthur flies back and is at National Airport, you know, coming in from San Francisco, all the JCS is there. You know, Marshall's there at the airport, you know, on the tarmac. And what is MacArthur, you know, what is he thinking? Gosh, are these guys in support of me? You know, that they're all here? Are they agreeing with my views? Because that's what he'll say to Congress, you know, the next day, is that my views fully supported by the Joint Chiefs of Staff. Then after the speech, MacArthur goes to the ceremony at the Washington Monument, and Marshall is there to greet him. You know, Marshall is right there, and they both look like they have friendly smiles, you know, and it's not going to come out until the May hearings before the Senate that, you know, MacArthur gets, you know, to understand that, no, none of these people were in concert with his views, officially and in public. Because you read about all these people and the background, and they all agree with what he's thinking. You know, that you can't deal with these, with, you know, the communists. You know, they are on a drive on their own. Even Marshall, who says that he was given, you know, real authority over the bomb by Truman, will be saying, you know, give Zhou Enlai a little, you know, atomic reasoning the next time you have some kind of communication with them. And so it's a bizarre thing, but everybody believes that the West will fall if they get involved with this Asian war, which might have been, who knows, you know. You know, what happened is what happened, and here we are, you know, 60 years or 70, 80 years left, you know, later, still left with it.
So interesting, because I feel like MacArthur and even his father before him, you know, as early as 1900s, they're saying, we need to pivot to Asia. We need to focus on Asia. We need to, you know, this is the source of our future kind of conflicts and issues and where our power can, you know, be exercised. And yet it's always a Europe first. It's World War One, Europe first, World War Two, Europe first.
Ideas. Yeah. Because, you know, during that whole Secretary of State phase with Marshall, you know, everything had been Europe, you know, right. Rebuilding, getting Germany back on their feet so that the Soviets couldn't take it over, you know, countermeasures in Greece, Turkey, propping up the British, you know, who are out of money. The French are just so worried about a German resurrection and getting clobbered again. And then they're worried about the Soviets moving through Germany and clobbering them again. So it's you know, a constant thing. And the Allies play very seriously into getting MacArthur out of there. You know, they blame everything that happens in Korea on him, you know, basically. And so it's just a different mindset. And, you know, you and I always go back to that cartoon of the globes where MacArthur looks at a square globe and Marshall's a round globe.
Yeah, totally different mindsets.
Yeah, the only thing pointing at MacArthur is that square globe of the Far East, because that's his concern, you know, that's his job. So,
right. Any final thoughts?
Marshall, you know, ends chief of staff or the SecDef in like 51, and MacArthur comes home, and they really have no correspondence or anything after that. And they don't really say anything about each other, you know, either. MacArthur will make those statements, you know, we gave up China in the 40s, but, you know, doesn't really label Marshall. You know, he gives those interviews in 54, where he calls out all the generals and everything about Asia and the firing and whatnot. Marshall's included in that. Those get printed after he dies. But, you know, there's like Frank Waldrop, who was a historian, MacArthur wrote him in 63 and said, you know, people always play on this animosity that Marshall and I have forever, which is complete garbage. We've always been fully in accord with each other. And so you're like, kind of, you know, what? The one thing though that always gets me though is in 53, you know, Marshall goes to the coronation of Queen Elizabeth. He's the US representative in England. And he's one of the few, or the one of the only Americans that gets invited to the service at Westminster Abbey, you know, the religious service. And everybody, they said, Brad, you won't find this in any British histories, but Bradley said when, because Omar Bradley is there with him, that when he goes into the chapel, everybody stands up for him. You know, when he goes to take his seat. Churchill goes up to the altar for communion or whatever, comes back, you know, breaks out of the ranks of people coming back, goes right to Marshall, shakes his hand. Lord Allenbrooke, same thing. Montgomery, same thing. And then at the reception afterward, Marshall is the only commoner that sits at the Queen's table, you know, there. And it's because they all knew, you know, it's like Churchill said, you know, if it wasn't for you, I don't think this thing would have ever come out, you know, for us, because he was that calm rock, you know, foundation that both Churchill, Roosevelt, and all those generals looked to. And it kind of goes to what Walter Kruger said about MacArthur. You know, in war, you have to have someone that's the leader. You have to have someone who, when everything is going crazy and chaotic and breaking down, and you think it's all going to fall apart, you got to have that someone that's like, no, it's not falling apart. Everything's fine. We're going to be getting through this. And I think, you know, ultimately, that's the way both of them are. And every American should be glad that they were both Americans.
Certainly.
Yeah.
Well, thanks, Jim.
Thank you, Amanda.